I think I've always used comedy as a way to cope.
Yeah.
I do think of comedy that way. Mm-hmm. And I mean, this podcast that I'm doing is called PTS Diva. It's much more direct.
Right.
And there's also a part of the show, at the end of every episode, there's something creative, like a monologue with a character that I do, or a radio sketch,
right,
or maybe some sort of... you know, a story that I tell, like a short story that's inspired by the trauma. So at the very end, you kind of get a reward. Like, I mean, not that the talking is on with other comedians, other people isn't rewarding,
right,
but at the end you get some sort of like the jewel, mm-hmm, like almost like you start with an oyster that's being irritated by grit and dirt, mm-hmm, and by the end of the hour, it's produced a pearl, hopefully.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's the idea.
That's great.
So I just wanted to do something different. I thought if I'm going to do this, I want it to be, you know.
Yeah, it sounds inspiring.
You know, so yeah. And I realized I reached a point in my life where I went, wow, there really isn't much that I can't empathize with. Like, mm-hmm, this, I've had everything happen to me.
Right.
And I used to think of it as a great curse. And now I think of it as a blessing in a way.
Yeah.
Right.
Because it allows me to have empathy with different people's traumas.
Right.
And also, I want people to know that it's not easy, but if you survive, you can come out the other side better.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I was kind of surprised. I'm not surprised, but you're always such a positive, funny, like light, like you always see whenever you...
I try to be. I think it's the only way to be.
Yeah, but the surprising part was that
how much
I was
ugliness?
Reading in your thing that you have, that you were through a lot.
Yes, yeah, yeah, and I mean, yeah, I can't deny it.
Right.
No, some terrible things happened in my life, and
do you talk about them on the podcast?
Yes, absolutely.
Which ones do you deal with?
Well, the show begins with the mother of all, which is cancer. I had cancer 10 years ago, and I beat it, but that really threw my life into a tailspin, and it's what made me leave Hollywood 10 years ago. One minute I was, you know, one minute I was at the bottom of the barrel, the next minute I wasn't even in a barrel. Literally, the barrel just kind of peeled away around me.
Yeah.
And one day I was okay. I mean, I wasn't doing great.
Right.
The next day I was on a plane home because I did not have health care, and it took a while to get better. And then after I got better, I decided I would reinvent myself as a stand-up, because that was what I'd always been afraid of until then. And I also realized the world had changed enough that I could be myself on stage. I didn't have to hide behind characters.
Right.
So that's the three major ones are the cancer, and then different injuries I had as a child, many like broken bones and diseases that I got when I was young. I had encephalitis when I was 16, and then the big one is the middle part, which is I lead people gently towards it. Mm-hmm. Is this the high school shooting that I was involved in when I was a boy?
Mm-hmm. Oh, really?
And so that's it. Like, I realized, you know, like this shooting stuff is it gets to me.
Yeah.
And when I was 16, I was the boy behind me shot up our school.
What?
And so we were. But it's a long time ago.
The boy who sat behind you?
Yeah, he was my neighbor. I grew up with him. I never say his name. I don't like to say his name. It's not that I don't want to make him famous, but no, because it's a long time. It was 40 years ago. But I don't like saying his name because he haunted me for so long. I was I didn't realize. See, back when I was young, you didn't have that word PTSD.
Right.
So and people would laugh at me. Like, I remember my first year of university. I mean, it took me at least 10 years before I could hear a car backfire and not hit the ground.
Yeah.
And but in those days, people mocked me for it. Like, don't be ridiculous.
Right. Suck it up.
Suck it up.
Right.
I remember in my first year of university, someone dropped a tray in the cafeteria. Mm-hmm. And the next thing you know, I've thrown my tray and I'm on the ground.
Yeah.
And that happened all the time. Crossing a street, I'd hear a car backfire. I'd hit the ground.
Oh my, of course.
It took me a long, long time. But I never dreamed as a kid that this would become a trend, like a thing.
Right.
I know.
It was such a... And this happened in Canada.
No,
these things never happen. Well, these things didn't happen
anywhere.
Yeah.
And so, even when it was happening, I still didn't really believe it was happening.
Was it a small school?
Well, 1,500 kids, is that a small school?
No, that's a pretty high large school.
Yeah, high school.
But then you knew that one kid out of that whole thing.
It was my class.
Yeah. Oh, man.
So he killed my teacher. That was one of the people. There were two dead in my class.
Oh, my God. So then he went out into you were in the classroom?
I was late, which saved my life.
You were late.
Which is why I'm always early now. Mm-hmm. I used to be, for a long time, I was always late, and I realized, I'm always late because I've internalized the idea that when you're late, you survive.
Right.
And then I realized that's silly because people don't know that.
Yeah.
And that's just dumb.
Right.
So then I changed, and now I try to always be early because
right.
I thought I got to let go of this magical thinking.
Yeah.
Being late doesn't save your life. It just did that day.
That, right.
You know,
right.
Luck out.
You did.
But I was in the hall racing when it began, so the shooting erupted.
So you were in the school.
Yeah. It was.
You were on. You were like 10 minutes. Like if you.
Well, it happened.
Four minutes. 5 minutes.
It was. If I'd been 1 minute early.
1 minute early.
30 seconds earlier, I'd be dead.
Oh my God!
Because he was right around the corner from me, literally 5 feet away, but right around the curve.
Oh man!
So when it began, I could smell the gunpowder. I could hear the gunshots. I'd never heard gunshots before.
Yeah.
I didn't know what they sounded like. I thought they were like the movies.
Right.
But they're not as dramatic as you think.
Mm-hmm.
And I just assumed it was balloons popping. And then I thought it was firecrackers. And then when I heard, I was so innocent that even when I smelled the gunpowder, I thought, it's firecrackers.
Right.
But then people started running. And then I saw blood on the floor. There was a pool of blood.
Oh, jeez.
And that's when I realized it was serious.
Yeah.
But I still didn't really react until the teacher grabbed me and said, "Get the fuck out of here."
Wow.
And I'd never heard a teacher swear before.
Yeah. Right.
And that was when I went, this is serious.
Holy cow.
And so, but I still was a kid that just thought it was television.
Yeah.
So he dragged me into a room where a bunch of kids were hiding, and very much like what you see today, and
right.
We hid under our desks. But the funny part, but my whole thing is, I went, I can make this funny.
Right.
Because it's been I've had enough time.
Yeah.
And I think it's important for people to realize, especially in this victim-based economy that we live in today, where now you actually get kudos for the most you've suffered.
Right.
And I just want this podcast kind of say, well, that's nonsense.
Yeah.
And you don't want to go through this, but you can come out the other side.
Yeah.
And for example, one of the funny things that happened was during the siege, we had this long, we're all under the desks. And I remember very clearly me going, "Are you sure we should be under the desk? Maybe we should flatten against the wall like they do on McLeod." And
really?
Then someone was like, "Yeah, but Cannon would get under the desk." And I'd be like, "Yeah, but he wouldn't fit under a desk." We had this big discussion. The
right.
teacher was like, he was just just traumatized.
Yeah.
But I remember we were children. We didn't really know what was happening.
No, of course.
But it was the first. But people react very differently.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I remember it was the first time I ever saw a jock cry.
Yeah.
Because he was like bawling.
Right.
And I was like, what the hell is going on here?
Yeah, you don't cry.
You don't cry. Because
yeah.
I reacted differently. I just became a chatterbox.
Oh, yeah.
And I just tried to make jokes constantly. Like, I remember when the principal came on and he was telling us he didn't know what was happening. But he was just saying, stay where you are. There's an incident.
Uh-huh.
And the police will be coming very soon to rescue us.
Right.
But we didn't know what
yeah.
was going on. And then he started to cry. And I remember whispering to the kid beside me, well, he's certainly no Churchill. So, you know what I mean? But that's...
yeah, you're just trying to survive with your wit.
Yeah.
And I remember at that point, the teacher that we were hiding with, because I just wouldn't shut up.
Yeah.
And he goes at one point, shut up, Dean. And I went, Dean, that's not me. That's I had a brother that was also in school. And we were a year apart. And we
right.
looked very much alike.
Uh-huh.
But he looked like a good-looking version of me. And I'm like his reflection in a mud puddle. And I went, Dean, I'm not Dean. But in the whole chaos, he assumed I was because that was his classroom. Because ironically, when the shooting began, my brother ran out because he didn't want to miss the excitement. And I ran in. So we replaced each other.
Yeah.
So for the whole time, he thought I was my brother.
Oh,
and so I go, well, that's not me. I'm Dean. And this is what the teacher said to me. He goes, oh, I'm so sorry, Scott. I had no idea. Trauma does terrible things to the face. So in like one sentence, what incredible shame.
Yeah.
He basically said, you're ugly right. and your brother's probably dead.
Oh, my God.
So that's,
oh, my God.
So, did you have to go back to that classroom?
Yes.
For the rest of the year?
Yes.
Wow. With yes. a different teacher?
Well, it was at the very end of the school year, uh-huh. so it was only like a month left. So they kind of just babysat us. They didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
Right.
Because there were two people missing. There were three shot in my class. The teacher was dead. He was dead. And we, all of our like, you know, our tests and all of our work was confiscated by the police to try to figure out what the motive was for any of it. Because she was his target.
Oh,
she
really?
She was his target.
That was the main?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, geez.
There were two teachers he wanted to take out and any other bastards who get in his way. That was his what his notes said.
Holy cow.
But yeah, it's a very different time because we were not, we were very much from a different generation. Like there was no coddling of any kind.
No, you know, that's what I was going to ask
no,
you.
No counselors.
No, yeah. And it's kind of gone the other way now.
We've gone absolutely the other way. Too far.
You think so?
Yeah. Absolutely.
That was going to be my question because
too much coddling?
I think coddling is the new abuse.
Yeah.
And I really think people need to toughen up.
I know that's maybe But it's not... a hard thing as a parent. It's a
I get that.
It's a hard thing when your kid says, like, I'm freaked out.
But
and you're like, okay, but the old school part of me thinks, okay, but that's not rational. It's not, it's not in your face. It's not here.
Yeah.
It's okay. Just toughen up and go for it. And then they keep saying, I'm freaking out, and their friends are freaking out, and you hear all these people, and I don't know if it's an LA thing, but we know so many kids that are going to therapy, and they haven't been involved in it. They just are being...
That to me is, honestly, I find that a little embarrassing.
Well, that's...
Is that wrong for me to say?
No, it's not.
I find it embarrassing, and I think it's a disservice to children,
right?
And I think we're fetishizing pain.
And that's my instinct.
That's really, and I can feel that I can say it because I've been through so
it.
Much.
Right.
So I don't think I'm being I don't think I'm being cold.
Right.
I'm actually saying you're doing a disservice to these children.
Right.
You're not equipping them for the real world. And for me, I'm very much tough love.
Right.
And I'm very much like I very much have always seen the world as a battleground.
Yeah.
And maybe that's because I'm a gay person as well when I came out into the middle of the AIDS epidemic.
Right.
So I don't really I grew up in a time where homosexuals were the most disgusting creatures on earth. So I've never really trusted society.
Yeah.
And so I've never really trusted what they say.
Uh-huh.
So, and I don't really care if people think I'm being too tough. I just go, you're not helping them because
right.
I know that when it happened to us, we didn't get counseling, which is wrong. We should have. And I didn't get counseling about the shooting until 30 years later when I got cancer because I'd never shown the pain because
right.
I didn't think it was, I didn't really know it was even there.
Right.
Until
well, you...
then. I didn't know until she asked me about, because I start, and that's what this podcast is about. I believe that I got cancer
mm-hmm.
because of undiagnosed PTSD.
Really?
And trauma that I never fully dealt with. That sat inside of me and just ate me up.
Mm-hmm.
And trauma that I never dealt with.
Right.
That kind of, I believe cancer loves many things. It likes cigarettes. It likes drugs. It likes pain. It loves pain more
uh-huh.
than anything. And so she asked me about different things. In Canada, when you're diagnosed with cancer, you're given a psychologist as well,
uh-huh.
like as part mm-hmm. of the healthcare system. And so I'd never spoken about it and I started talking about it. And she asked me about things in my childhood. And the next thing I know, I'm weeping like a baby. Mm-hmm. I hadn't cried since the day after the shooting, many years ago with my
right.
mother
mm-hmm.
at the kitchen table when we were looking at the kids that had been killed. But I had never cried since. I locked it away because it was too traumatic.
Yeah.
And I believe that cancer took that seed and then the rest of my life, it built upon it with all the other traumas.
Right.
And I think that it kind of in a strange way, it changed me back then because it made me... This is a weird thing, but even my own, I look at my career and the path that I took.
Yeah.
I kind of fell in love with survival, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
It's like when a kid comes from a war zone, you're never the same. And you kind of, if you don't deal with it, you'll keep picking at that wound the rest of your life.
Right.
And the truthful thing is, it's a very ugly thing to admit, but there's nothing, there's no greater high than surviving something like that.
Yeah.
Like whether it's cancer or a massacre, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or an avalanche or any of those things. But when you survive, that high is like nothing I've ever had. And I think I've been chasing it. Like even coming out when I did at the beginning, when no one was coming out, people were like, that's insane. That will kill your career. And they were right.
What year?
Well, on television, 1989.
Wow.
In the Kids in the Hall first special, before the series even began.
Right.
And nobody did that. And
right.
I was extremely naive about what I would unleash with that. And I did not understand, but I don't regret it. But I had this feeling that my whole thing as a kid was very kamikaze. I'm like, I'm going to throw myself off this cliff and I know I'll survive.
Right. Another survival thing.
Yes. And that's what even stand-up comedy, like comedy is very much that. We throw ourselves off a cliff and we trust in our talent and we trust in our relationship with the audience and the jokes that we've written that they will be a parachute that will get us to the ground. And so I think that I chose a career that was absolutely perfect for a person in love with survival.
Yeah.
And
but it's interesting, the comic in you, the funny person in you, who's making those jokes during the school thing, who's never really addressing it, that is how we cope.
Yes.
And I always see it as a kind of a secret superpower.
Yes.
That no matter what you throw at us, we're going to be able to laugh at it, right?
Yeah.
If somebody's died, comedians will be making jokes about that person
instantly, immediately. And no matter how much you love that person.
No, and I see it mainly as positive. Well, thank you so much for coming in, Scott.
Thank you.
Really, always been so much fun to watch. And this sounds very, very interesting. I mean, we could talk to you for hours. Good.
Yeah, check out Scott Thompson's podcast, PTS Diva.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming in.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks for watching What a Joke.
Make sure to comment, like, subscribe.
Tell us what guests you'd like us to have on.
Yeah, you tell us.
Do something.